Welcome to a new test and teardown video. Yeah, I was lucky to get a new Heathkit SB-610, and that is a station monitoring unit. And I actually figured out that SB stands for sideband series. So this is for radio amateur kind of stuff. So I don't think you can use this instrument for a lot of stuff if you're not a radio amateur and using really old long wave radio bands and stuff like that. But it also got a scope mode, so you can actually use this as an oscilloscope with vertical and horizontal inputs. So I think this is what we're going to aim for in this video. It is in a very, very good condition. Look how beautiful it is. There isn't any dirt or dust or any nasty yellow stuff on this. It's super, super clean. That is great. But there is actually one little thing that worries me a little bit. And that is this 120 volts. I mean, this was, of course, an American kit, but it is obviously here in Europe. Somebody bought this, had it shipped here, assembled this, and did not scrape away the 120 and change this the text. That's a little bit annoying, so maybe this is imported as already assembled and then resold, and I don't know what. So what's going to happen when I power this up with 230 volts? I mean, it's going to blow up, right? So I will have to open this and inspect the wiring. And we're inside. That was super, super easy. So what is it I am looking for? It was super easy, as always with Heathkit, to find manual schematics and all that kind of stuff. It's really good to read everything and know how this works and what was the ideas and all that. And about the mains transformer wiring for either a US power or Euro power, you actually find this is mains entry. And here is a black wire that goes to the transformer, and that goes directly to mains. That is actually wrong. It should have been the black and red wire that should go here. But so they just swapped those two wires. It's not that important, but here's the fuse and the switch, and that is the black and red. The other two wires, they are in series. It's right here. It's not that easy to see, but one should be black and yellow, and the other one should be black and green. Well, that is definitely the two wires. So yes, the two primary windings, they are in series correctly. So I can plug this into my local mains, and we should be fine. I've been inspecting everything here, and it's looking quite all right. This is actually a very impressive a DIY project. This is not the most easy one to perform. As you can see, there's like a lot of components, and it is like, look how close parts are, especially around the two more integrated tubes. Yes, this unit uses integrated tubes. I think those got like three tubes in them, like two diodes and one triode and stuff like that. So they're more integrated compared to the more normal tubes that's like only containing like two triodes and stuff like that. So I think it is power up time. You're here, you can see you can even see they're called compactrons. They are quite rare collector's item today. Those tubes, and this one looks beautiful. And here's the other one. The small one. Wow, huh? Compactron. And this is, of course, a good way to save number of bulbs in this thing. You can see it looks like, hey, we only got like 4 lamps. Yips. And a lot more. Yeah, I think you can see they are quite compact and integrated. So this is called SB-610E. Uh-huh. This is not written on the front, but it's written down here. So maybe there is something special I need to look in the schematics and stuff. I don't know. What is that one doing? And the power bulb. I think I see a little bit of yellow on that pot up there. It looks a little bit dangerous with that. Aha, that is chassis. See that wire, that is chassis, so we don't need to be afraid of that. A classic tube way to build this stuff. That is just this ground wires around, and okay, we just feel lucky about maybe there is a good connection to ground. I don't know. Oh yeah, there is actually a thin little wire down here as well. Oh man. Yeah, you can actually see. Let me try and clean this a little bit. You can see the 3 tubes in this one here on the top. It's real easy. Now that I clean it a little bit, you see the 3 filaments in this little integrated circuit. We are ready for the first power up experiment. Let's turn off a little bit of all this light so we can probably see a little bit more. Oh yeah, again, ground your chassis and then you will survive. What if there is a leak from your mains to your chassis? You're probably gonna get killed, right? So I much rather have one of my relays shut off and kill the power here. So this is our first power on. I will turn off here. Mains is applied. And we can sit down and enjoy a second of readiness. Look at that. 42. 30 watts and 28 watts. I think this is promising. Look at that! Yeah! This should be intensity or something, right? But look! Where the heck is focus? Okay, it's just completely... Okay, wow! Ha ha! Whoa! But I mean, it is definitely alive. I mean, this looks like absolutely like crap. Focus is not working at all. There's, oh yeah. Do you see a slight response or no response at all? I see a tiny little response here. So something tells me we have a problem. Also, I would expect the intensity to be very much affected by this. So we definitely have a huge problem in the high voltage supply that goes to this. And I think we should definitely look a little bit on the schematics around the cathode circuit, because that is intensity and focus and cathode and all that kind of stuff. Definitely, what voltage have we got in this area? Yep. So here's my findings. That was a very, very easy checkup here. So what I did is I wrote a little bit of information on the capacitors of interest. Plus 600, plus 300, all that is good. All right, here is the high voltage. So minus 1600. So that means it's just way off, way too much voltage here. It should have been like minus 1400. And so that voltage go to the intensity and to the focus pot meter. And the focus pot meter got a 3.3 mega ohm to ground. But there was also minus 1600 on that. Really? So I disconnected that one from the focus pot and measured. There's nothing in that resistor anymore, so it's completely open. And it looks like this is not an original oldie anymore. Look how everything else looks. So somebody put in a resistor that cannot handle the heat and the voltage and the good stuff. So I'm going to try and change this resistor and see if it works. Here's my 3.3 mega ohm resistor that can handle a lot of voltage and a lot of pain. And what do you know? Of course it works. Oops, it's of course upside down. But here's my focus. Yeah, and here's my intensity. Everything is back. Yeah. No big surprise. Let's just see. What is the voltage? Yeah. 1460. Exactly as they say. So that is perfect. So I'm actually going to try and input some signals into the horizontal and vertical inputs. But before I do that, I just wanted to verify that I'm not going to blow up any of my other equipment. And what exactly is going to happen is, this is the input switch where you select the different input modes, right? So this is internal sweep, and then we can go and select external for horizontal and all that kind of good stuff, right? So while I'm rotating this switch, let's have a little look on the voltmeter here on the horizontal connector. Okay, DC mode, and then I turn the switch. Hello. Oops, 120 volts, and then it discharges. Is that good for your signal generator? To hammer out like 120 volts into it? This is obviously the horizontal deflection that goes straight, or there is like over a capacitor, and then you just go straight out, and there is no discharge, there is no nothing. I mean, this is not good. Pam. Oh no. This is how you break your stuff. What you see here is the vertical amplifier tube, and it was coupled for 1.4 megahertz input and output frequencies. But as you see in the schematic section, you can also couple it as a wideband amplifier. So this is what I've done here with 15 kilo ohms to the anode supply, and this is the output capacitor, and the input. They actually talk about a direct connection from the input to the vertical pot meter, but I just left the capacitor here. And now it actually works a lot different. Look at this. So I got some input, and I can even change the... Yeah. Look at that. So that is my vertical input. And obviously this amplifier isn't linear, as you can see here. This is supposed to be a sine wave. See if I got a very low. Oh, let me adjust the frequency a little bit. Like that, right? See? Vertical gain here. And then it goes It's actually funny how it... Yeah. Well. I think I'm done playing with this unit now, because it's actually doing what it is supposed to do. So now we'll assemble it again and call it a day and have a little Friday party here. So see ya. Bye. Yeah, this is better. Now it's not upside down. That was terrible. I am so sorry. Ooh, look at that. But it is definitely back alive again. Ooh, yoy, 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 yoy. Here we can really see. Everything is just a little bit unstable.